heart and the right mind as we sing songs to you. Father, help the songs not to be just a tradition or emotions we go through. Help us, Father, to sing from our heart. Help us to be real and to be genuine, to be sincere in our worship, in our praise of you, God. Father, help us to connect with you always, but especially this morning, as we gather as your family. And help us even now, God, as we prepare our hearts and our minds to take communion, to be ready for that, Father. To be ready in heart and mind as we obey you in one of the very few things that you ask us to do repeatedly. One of the only traditions that you set down before us. Help us to take it in a manner that is worthy and that honors you. Help us not to take communion lightly, God. And that if we're in sin and unrepentant sin, to not take it and get our hearts right and then come back and take it again. God, help us, Father, to be a people who are true and honest before you, who live in humility, who are inspired by your word and by your spirit, and who love you wholeheartedly. Help us, God, in our weakness to overcome our weakness, in our sins to overcome those, and to nail them to the cross, and to be a people who are true and righteous and holy, who are an honor and a joy to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You know, a few years back, I believe it was 1991, a Brinks truck. We were living in Miami, Florida, and a Brinks truck that was going over an overpass right over Liberty City, which is one of the poorest neighborhoods in Miami, the neighborhood where the famous Miami race riots happened. A Brinks truck was going over the overpass, and it tipped over and rolled, and $3.2 million fell out, and then fell over the sides and came raining down on Liberty City neighborhood. Imagine what the people were thinking as they looked outside and saw money floating down from the sky. As they heard pennies and coins dropping, I don't know, maybe they were roll coins, maybe they were making thuds on their cars. Imagine everybody running out and grabbing as much money as they could, and you know, of course, the Brinks immediately sent lots of people there. The police swarmed on the scene, and the fire department, everybody was there trying to gather the money as fast as they could. And they gathered up most, but there was still $550,000 missing that they weren't able to gather. And so they put an ad in the paper asking everybody to please return the money. Well, they didn't get a whole lot back. There was an 11-year-old boy who came to the police station and turned in $20.32 that he found. They rewarded him. I don't remember what the amount was, but they gave him a reward. And of course, the media was pretty excited about it, that one person had the integrity, had the character to bring back. And you know, you may think, well, you know, $20, that's not a lot of money. But you know, for an 11-year-old, $20 is a lot of money. You know, that's like you or I finding $1,000 or $10,000, you know? That's a lot of money. Imagine how excited everybody was, you know, and mysteriously, a lot of brand new cars appeared within a couple of weeks after that. Can you imagine finding that much money? You know, right now, I believe the lotto is pretty high. I don't know exactly how high it is, but I stopped at 7-Eleven, and they had a big sign saying, Lotto Alert. It was like $330 million or something like that. And you know, there's a lot of people buying lotto tickets right now because they want a shot at that $330 million. They want, I mean, can you imagine? You can imagine, you know, just everybody's probably thinking, you know, what would I do with $330 million? Or okay, even if Uncle Sam took a third of it, still $200 million. Maybe he takes half, I don't know. Still, $100 million. You can do a lot with that. Everybody would love to just have, bam, an easy way to do things, wouldn't you? Wouldn't you?
Right.
I mean, that's what we want. Everybody would like a shortcut in life. To be able to get bailed out in one way or another, you know? To be able to get And the easiest one, usually, the most obvious one, is to get a whole boatload of money. You just pay off all your bills, and you can just be scot-free. Of course, we forget that the more money we have, the more stuff we tend to buy, right? And we buy stuff to make our life easier, right? But then we gotta pay for that stuff. And then we gotta work more to pay for the stuff that's supposed to be making our life easier, right? And then we get stressed out about having to work more and to pay for all that stuff. And then we get like we're working a lot and we're stressed out a lot just so we can pay for those things that are making our life easier. You see the vicious cycle, right? It's like the guy who went to a villager. There was a village in the Caribbean, and they were catching these huge fish. And this tourist businessman saw him, and he said, you know, this is incredible. I've never seen anybody fish like this. The fishermen would go out for about an hour a day, catch a boatload of fish, come home, sell his fish, and spend the rest of the day at home with his family and doing stuff around the house. And he said, do you realize how much money you could make doing this? I mean, you've got an incredible secret here. The fishing here is amazing. We can get you set up so you're catching 3 times as much fish or 10 times. If we got you a big fishing boat, you could be making lots of money and you could be doing lots of stuff with your family. And he said, well, then I would have to, you could have a bigger house. I said, well, then I'd have to take care of my house and have to pay for people. And he said, yeah, but you could hire servants and they could do that and you could have this and you could have that. And then he said, but why would I do that? He said, then you could spend more time with your family. He said, I already spend time with my family. See the vicious cycle. We'd all like an easy button, wouldn't we? We all like to just push a button and all our troubles go away. Push a button and all our bills are gone. Push a button and all those problem relationships, they're resolved. Everybody apologizes to me. Yeah, that's the easy button, right? We like things to be smooth and problem-free. I had a brother tell me one the other day, he said, you know, bro, I think I realized I'm a conflict avoider. I said, welcome to the club of the human race. We're all conflict avoiders. We don't like conflict. I don't know anybody who just loves conflict. Boy, I can hardly wait to get into this one. We don't like it to be easy, to be smooth. Our world is in search of easy outs all the time, of easy buttons to press. If you're hurting, take a pill. If you're struggling, have a drink. If life is overwhelming, smoke something. Numb yourself out. Check out. Run. Hide. Don't. Whatever you do, just make yourself happy. That is the way of our world. It's to avoid the challenges, to avoid suffering. You know, suffering, nobody likes to suffer. Right? I mean, no, people don't line up for suffering. It's something we pray to God every day that we don't have to suffer, that we don't like to suffer, but unfortunately, suffering just seems to be part of the plan, whether we like it or not. Even Jesus.